This is part three of a monthly series that is brought to you by the Big Sky Conference. This is in response to the increased need for mental health support. The Big Sky Conference has created a mental health subcommittee, which has members from all different schools. We meet on a weekly basis. We have members ranging from athletic training, student athletes, coaching staff, and other support services that work directly with students. My name is Aaron Grisonic. I'm going to be your moderator today. I'm joined with a multidisciplinary panel of professionals who are all here to discuss suicide prevention. Today, we are going to be talking about a number of topics related to suicide. And so I know this topic can be difficult for people, especially if suicide has touched you in your life in some way. So please bear with us. I think we're going to try to approach this from a practical and pragmatic point of view. We will have some time for questions at the end. Joining me today, we have Derek Rosinski from Weber State. He's the Director of Strength and Conditioning. We have Jen Zelmer Korsma from University of Montana, Director of Student Athlete Support Services. Cindy Miller from Portland State, athlete, clinical consultant, and a mental health provider in that community. Chris Walsh from Idaho State, he's the Director of Athlete Training Services. And Gloria Petrozelli from Sacramento State, she's a sports psychologist and a clinical licensed psychologist there as well. I just want to point out that we have a group of people here today, which represents the people across different areas of expertise, but they all touch students in a different way, and we're really looking forward to hearing their perspective and their tips and their tactics when approaching students who might be at risk and people they might be worried about. Today, we're going to be talking about a few different things with regard to suicide. We'll be talking about some statistics briefly about how suicide impacts athletes in particular. We'll be talking about the intersection between race, COVID, and mental health issues, identifying students at risk, steps for engaging with students if you find them to be at risk, and how to stay connected with your team. Suicide prevention is not the job of a single person. It's a team effort, and communicating with members of your team is really important. And again, we'll have time for some questions at the end. Really quickly, just to wrap our minds around student athletes and the suicide risk for them. Now, according to a 9-year study that the NCAA did a few years back, suicide and risk for suicide, athletes were found to be a little bit less at risk than the normal population of college students. They identified that 83% of male athletes versus 17% of female athletes had in fact taken their lives. Football was identified as being the sport with the highest risk for suicide. We'll talk about some of those risk factors in a minute. And while the suicide rate of collegiate athletes amounts to about one in every 100,000 per year, the difference between suicide and other causes of death is that suicide is entirely preventable if somebody is given the right resources and help. Let's move along, and we're going to talk a little bit about racism, racial injustice, and violence, and how those contribute to mental health struggles. With all that's going on in the country right now and in the world regarding the pandemic, human rights movement, and the election, there's a lot of turmoil, strife, and uncertainty in our lives, and most importantly, in the lives of our athletes. Gloria, if you could start us off, I was wondering if you could share a little bit about what you discussed the other day about how these factors kind of have a cumulative effect on student athletes and how may that may be an increase for their mental health issues.
Yeah, thank you, Aaron, and welcome everybody. So It's important to know, earlier in the year, the NCAA did a COVID and mental health study. And so they surveyed D1, D2, and D3 athletes. And what they found is that student athletes are endorsing, due to the impacts of COVID since March, they've been reporting higher rates of mental health concerns related to the financial impacts, the social distancing and the limitations, the cancellation of sports. And so, to recognize that this is a risk factor. And then also to note that in that study, communities of color, so student athletes of color were at higher risk and more negatively impacted. So their rates went up. And so we want to talk about, I think this is important, our committee decided to make sure that we're understanding the context in which we're talking and giving these doing this talk today, right? To understand that racism, racial injustice, all are impacting our student athletes' mental health, consciously or unconsciously. And recently, the American Medical Association just came out with a statement to acknowledge that racism is a threat to public health, right? So mental health isn't separate from that. And we often, as you'll hear today, we work with medical professionals, as a part of this approach to suicide prevention. And so it's important to note that because when we, many of our students, and if they identify, their identities are cross-sectional or intersectional, right? And so we have to understand that these student athletes, outside of being an athlete and a student, they may have different roles in their families, right? So pre-COVID, many of them may have stayed on campus. Now during COVID, many of them have moved home. And depending on how financially impacted their family is, they may take up jobs, other responsibilities that previously they weren't having to do. And so, this added responsibility and role on top of being a student, being an athlete, can and is impacting their mental health. And so we're seeing more student athletes reporting that, how to balance these added responsibilities, especially if they are in quarantine and isolation, right? There's that added stress and kind of interruption in their lives. I don't know if anybody on the panel wants to chime in as well.
I would just like to comment in terms of the racial piece, that now is front and center in the news, but it's my experience having been working in this space for 25 years, primarily at Oregon State, that's always been a case, particularly with students of color coming into predominantly white institutions, which certainly is the case in Corvallis and in Portland in many ways. So I think it's important to recognize that COVID is about now, racism is about always.
Hey, Chris and Derek, each of you work with athletes. What do you notice being on their minds, and what's the vibe like with COVID and racism or bias and things like that?
Well, I guess I'll jump in first. Obviously COVID has taken, everybody's attention. I guess that's the topic of conversation for like the last 6 months. So, what we've been trying to create, and I think every department, nationally is just trying to bring some sort of normalcy back to student athletes. But I think mental health has always been a concern of ours, especially in the sports medicine side. We work closely, with mental health professionals, and that's always been a topic of concern for us, spanning years. So this has just kind of exacerbated everything. And there's so many different challenges that we've faced. And again, I think, what the general public doesn't know is, the majority of the Big Sky Conference schools, at least, we've been trying to bring our student athletes back since June. So they've been here, they've been on campus, they've been in there with their teams, for a long time. This has been a long stretch for all of us. I mean, staff, but really, student athletes, this has been a lot. So it's really, it's been totally different. you know, and the isolation, the self-isolation, the self-quarantine challenges, you know, that's been really, really tough. And I don't think anybody was prepared for it. And we're learning as we go. So it's been a challenge.
Yeah, I can echo that sentiment. You know, just speaking with my other members of my staff that handle all our other teams and talking to colleagues across the country. I mean, it's been a challenge to keep everybody focused. I think that's been the biggest thing across every sport. You know, every team's a little bit different, but a lot of it comes down to where are we going? You know, okay, we don't have a fall season. As soon as that got canceled, okay, what's next? Keeping the kids focused was the first challenge, you know, and you know, the vibe there for a bit was, okay, hey, we're back. Okay, awesome. Once you're back, what do we got next? You know, just fighting through the uncertainty of what are we training for? What are we preparing for? You know, I think everybody's dealing with that same issue. You know, so the vibe has kind of ebbed and flowed a little bit. It's kind of changed here and there. And it depends if your students are on campus or off campus. You know, we've been fortunate for the most part of having our kids here. And I know that talking to a lot of other people or certain teams of ours that haven't been here, you know, the struggles of having them home and some of the kids that are here and some that aren't on certain teams, the combination, the ones that are here want their teammates here, you know, and the ones that aren't here want to be here with them. And it's an interesting vibe. And like I said, it kind of ebbs and flows depending on the information they're finding out when their seasons are approaching, you know, whether they're the adjusted seasons or basketball season coming up. So it's been unique for them.
You know, Derek, you mentioned across the country, you know, talking to your colleagues. And I think similarly, all of us on this panel are probably connected to those, you know, to other folks across the country. And I think what we're seeing is that more universities are now making the mental health piece a little more formalized, right? So either making sure they contract with mental health providers, a department, or making sure they have an embedded mental health person, a part of their sports medicine team. So I think that, you know, I know this initially when the NCAA came out with their mental health best practices, that was one of the best practices they encouraged. And I think with COVID hitting and the wave that's happened from that, we're seeing that more and working more as a team, right? Mental health providers being a part of the sports medicine team and strength and conditioning team. You bring up a really good point.
Jen, you work with student athletes in a student services role. I was curious if you were noticing anything unique that students are struggling with currently.
Thanks, Aaron. Yes, absolutely. And I would echo everything that pretty much everyone has said here already. We've seen a heightened sense of being overwhelmed, anxiety for their classes. They're overloaded on online and Zoom efforts and email overloads and getting that information and trying to track it and stay on top of things. And also with their uncertainties with their sports, this is the first time that they haven't gone into a regular schedule that they've always had with their sports since they've probably been 6 or 10 or 15 years old. There's always been a structure for when things start, when things end, and when things continue. And so that uncertainty is causing them some stress. So they're increasing that at higher levels than normal. And I would also echo Chris and Derek's comment about the quarantining. The quarantining for positive tests, but also quarantining for close contacts is adding stress because people are lonely, they're isolated, they don't have family here to engage with them or check in on them every single day. And the training room and coaches and staff and everyone are trying so hard to do that with everybody, but there are times when that doesn't actually occur as much as it needs to, I think. So it's causing additional anxiety. And though there are a lot of frustration and struggles cropping up with the racism issues that have come to light and that have always been present. We feel here at UM that we are seeing a positive energy against this racial injustice with the initiatives in education that are developing that are student focused. So I think there are some efforts, and I would say this across all schools at the Big Sky Conference, that everyone is doing their best part to help alleviate these stresses, but they are very much unique and growing on a rate at a faster rate, I think, this fall semester than at any other point in time.
Yeah, I think as people have been talking, something I've heard universally is change, adapt, and not knowing any answers about what the future might hold. And you know, I think that it's difficult for our students, and it's difficult for all of the people here on this panel and also listening. And it puts us all, whether you're a coach or another capacity working with students, it puts us in a strange situation where we're dealing with the same stresses that the students are dealing with, but also trying to provide them help and support at the same time. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen back again. See if I can get these slides back up. Let me work on that for a minute. So let's go ahead and move on to talk a little bit about some of the risk factors with athletes. And I'll get my screen back up as we do that. I think that as we talked as a panel, some of the main risk factors related to athletes involve major changes in their life, just what we talked about, dealing with the unknown, managing pressures that they may feel, certain emotional struggles, anxiety and depression being the biggest, interpersonal or team dynamics, and also feeling isolated or alone. And while many other factors may increase the risk for suicide, I think it might be a good idea for the mental health experts to maybe start us off and discuss some of those areas. Cindy, what are your thoughts about working with athletes and the risk factors that they may have?
Well, to me, what I'm seeing primarily is with the students who are already in treatment or recently been referred. And so in some ways, they already have a built-in support because they're talking to me. And what I'm seeing is very much connected to what other people have talked about, which is that the students, athletes in many ways, are at a higher risk factor because they're so used to external structure, managing their time and managing their motivation. And so the kids who actually have a capacity to structure their lives from the inside out are doing better than the other. But I think everyone in general is experiencing, the threshold for experiencing mental health symptoms is so much lower for all of us. And so then it's a matter of making sure in some ways that people are having increased contact with their athletes, whether it's through academics, whether it's through the training room, whether it's through coaches. That to me is the best prevention we can do, is just to make sure that these kids feel connected to their schools and to other people, because everyone's symptomatic right now, and it's just a matter of degree to which one is symptomatic and when interventions need to take place.
Gloria, thoughts for you?
Yeah, I mean, I echo everything Cindy is saying. And I think making sure that, the connectivity, how many actual, connections are you making with that athlete on a weekly basis, on a daily basis? Because as we were talking offline in prep for this panel, you know, pre-COVID, the athlete's walking through campus, through other academic buildings, through the training room, through the administration room, through their coach's office. And so they may interface with 20 people just, walking from one side of campus to the other. And now that routine is thrown off. And now the intentional connection of, calling a trainer or sports med or getting that team meeting. And even in a team meeting, if you have a larger team like track or football, you're just a face on the screen. So I think that is probably one of the biggest risk factors that we as staff and professionals need to be mindful of, because that has gone down, which means what we're cueing into and being able to read into these risk factors are different, because before we could see someone's body language, which is a big tell, right? If they're not making eye contact, if they have, you know, their hat pulled down, you can kind of tell like, okay, what's going on? Whereas now they just have to turn the camera off. And so I think we need to be more intentional about asking about these specific things. Hey, have you had any life changes? Hey, how are you feeling about your expectations on this team? Hey, are you feeling any other mood and emotion symptoms right now that you need support with, right? So I think really offline, all of us were kind of echoing this need for relationship building. And that's how we get this information to be able to know how much risk an athlete is at.
You know,
go ahead, Cindy. Go ahead.
Yeah, one quick thing that hasn't been listed. Substance use, and particularly in the it's not uncommon in the absence of testing to have increased marijuana use in any athletic group. But I'm just seeing substance use and abuse and misuse. That's at a much higher rate, which again, if we're not seeing kids, Gloria, like you said, it's sort of hard to perceive that. And of course I get it with the kids in treatment because they're telling me. But I think that's something that isn't on the list that we need to be very mindful for, because it's true in our culture too.
And I would add a risk factor, especially related to student athletes and unique to them, is the major. The average student changes their major 4 times before they actually graduate from college. And student athletes do not have the flexibility, as many of us know on this panel and in this conversation, that they do not have the flexibility to change their major 4 times before they graduate without having some impact on their eligibility. So that increases their stress load. They're going a couple of years and the light bulb comes on and they say, absolutely, that's not the major I want to pursue. And they want to pursue something different. So then we're looking at, do you continue on with that major just to stay eligible to play your sport and then add on more academic years? Or do you find another route to be able to make this work? And I think that is a unique stress to student athletes that heightens their difficulty with academics at all levels, besides the schedule that they keep alone with all the responsibilities that they have. So I think that impacts it tremendously.
Let's go ahead and move on to talk a little bit about identifying students at risk. I know we talked a little bit about this already, a few things that we talked about as a group in terms of identifying students at risk is it's really hard to predict somebody's future behavior. The only real information that we have about what future behavior may entail is their past behavior, their history. And I think asking questions about how have people dealt with struggles in the past recognizing or noting that is important. Again, change. Noticing change is really important. If a change occurs with a student, and I always say, you know, the grouchy, grumpy student who's normally grumpy and who's all of a sudden happy and go lucky, that's a change that may need some attention. Just like the student who's happy and engaged with people who starts isolating and stops talking to people, that's also a change that might need attention. And so looking at change, changes in mood, demeanor, health-related or somatic complaints, quality in their performance on the field or meeting other team obligations. Isolation is really big. And then some other common things, withdrawal from friends and family, expressions outwardly or discussions that you may hear them having with their teammates about hopelessness or maybe guilt, giving possessions away, comments that life isn't worth the trouble or just things don't seem worth the trouble anymore, and recurrent thoughts or statements about suicide. All of those things can be indicators of that somebody's struggling with something. I'll turn it over to the panelists, and I think it might be good if we could each just go down, give about maybe 30 seconds or so each, just mindful of the time, and to talk about some of the different things that you see in terms of risk factors in your own professional capacity. Chris, do you want to give us a start here?
Yeah, you know, I think most sports medicine departments, you know, we partner with counseling and testing centers, you know, to kind of to add in a mental health element into our screening every year. So that, I mean, for us personally, that's been really, really useful. That's something that we implemented a few years ago. And it's actually quite shocking to, you know, to see what these student athletes, these freshmen coming in, a lot of times that they're willing to share right off the bat without knowing anybody. So I think, again, having that knowledge right in the forefront and providing those resources has been really beneficial and really helpful. And I think that's the direction that we'll continue to go and that we all should continue to go as find this on the front end. And one thing I just wanted to mention, you know, our role in sports medicine and any medical side, you know, we try to separate ourselves from the sports side of it. But I mean, obviously, sports performance issues, academic issues, not showing up to study hall in class, these are all more than just kids not wanting to do this stuff. It's there is a mental health tie into this. And I think that's really important for all of us to recognize that just because somebody has a bad practice or they're failing in class, doesn't mean that, you know, that again, they're just being lazy. I mean, there's more to it. So I think that's kind of a starting point, and just that's kind of one of those flags that we need to kind of, as coaches, administrators, and staff, that we need to say, hey, maybe something's not right.
How about you, Gloria?
You know, yeah, just to kind of piggyback off of what Chris said, you know, for our program at Sac State, we do mental health screening on all first year student athletes at their physical. And so, you know, in the last 4 years, every student athlete on Sac State's campus, whether transfer or incoming, has been screened by Student Health and Counseling Services. And my role is to review them, to identify flagged ones. So at the outset, similarly, we're getting these first year student athletes endorsing, you know, anxiety related to adjustment, new expectations, a transition. And so that's not necessarily a risk factor, but it puts them on my radar, right? And so being able to just kind of take note and understand that some of these incoming folks are struggling a little bit more. And then on the more severe level, and I know this probably goes for everybody, but specifically for Cindy, experiencing students when they say like, life doesn't matter. You know, I wish I could just escape everything and disappear, right? So those statements, everyone would be better off without me, my team doesn't need me, what's the point of being here? Those are, like, you hear those statements and your ears perk up, right? And so if there's a takeaway from this, it's like, really take those statements seriously. And those are getting closer into the risk assessment piece, right? So we have risk factors kind of leading up, and then we have those really more extreme points where you realize maybe a student is really thinking about considering suicide as an option. So I'll pass it on.
I guess I wanna dovetail on that. And what I'm gonna speak to now is way trickier to identify. And those are the kids who are remarkably good at masking their discomfort. And athletes in general are used to tolerating a great deal of discomfort. And this is true in the emotional and mental health realm too. And so then they often might dismiss an uncomfortable feeling, and particularly the kids who are the people pleasers, and those often come in the version of women more than men. But with men, it's sort of the guy who's life of the party, always making jokes, always having fun, always making everyone else feel good. And I think the changes in those individuals tend to be extraordinarily subtle. And in some ways it's important that we need to check in on all kids, and not just, it's easy because you can check in with them. Hey, how are you thinking? Oh yeah, now I know it's really hard, but I'm doing, and it's like, wait a second. You know, of course it's really hard, but tell me how it's hard for you. And just give those kids a little more time. Because for example, I mean, everything that is known, including with Tyler Helinski's parents, he was a people-pleasing young man. He was life of the party. He was the caretaker of everybody. And it was only really subtle clues in the last week, and they were so subtle, clearly no one picked up on it prior to him shooting himself. And so it's important to keep track of those kids too. It, in some ways it's easier with the ones who declare it, but it's the ones where it's more subtle.
I agree, and I think that's, I'll just maybe push through points that have already been stated, but that's where what Gloria talked about, that early intervention through the screenings, recognizing what students are dealing with when they're coming in, getting to know the student athlete on a personal basis. And I know a lot of our coaches are those people who are the go-to people for the students, but knowing them at that kind of baseline. So when those changes, even if they're subtle, take place, a flag can go up that might be a discussion item. Jen, did you have any thoughts for us?
Yeah, I would say in terms of academics, identifying it is, we see it definitely in increased missed classes, an immediate decrease in the grades. They're not coming to their regular check-ins. They're not responding to the emails that we might be sending them out to them. We have some graduate student mentors that work with our student athletes here at UM also, and they share their concerns that they're seeing something. I think it's really important that a strong relationship is built between the advisors and the professors on campus, because many of our professors are really great about expressing a concern when a student athlete hasn't regularly been in class. Of course, through midterm or grade checks, you can see some of that stuff, but a strong relationship helps when professors reach out and express a concern. And I think it's especially important in academics that you notice those, see them when they're coming, and start working with the students and the coaches to have a conversation about what's happening and why there's a struggle or a downturn in the performance with their academics.
Thank you. And Derek, what about you, coming from a strength and conditioning standpoint?
Yeah, you know, in our world, obviously we track a lot of numbers, and, you know, everybody has their metrics that they track in our world, whether it's a speed numbers or lifting numbers. And you can see, you know, if somebody is having a great training block and all of a sudden something drops off, right? Significant change in performance. That's a huge red flag for us. You know, if the kid's doing awesome and all of a sudden things just start dropping off, they're showing up late, you know, they're a girl or a guy that's just always functional 5-10 minutes early, and all of a sudden they're 5-10 minutes late, or, you know, there's, okay, what's wrong with going on here? Obviously we track a lot of body weights, body compositions with athletes. You know, if we see drastic changes, sometimes going up, sometimes going down, you know, weight gain, weight loss can be a huge one, especially significant, fast. You know, that can be a huge indicator for us. And kind of the unknown one, the hidden one is body language. You know, in my world, especially with, you know, sports like football and basketball a lot, we tend to see these kids more than the actual coaches, you know, because we'll see them at practice, at lifts, and get, you know, week games, hotels. You know, if there's some times where you can be a happy-go-lucky kid and all of a sudden, you know, his mood tanks and his body language, his eyes, like you talk about his eyes drop in conversation, or shoulders start slouching, his pace during his training is different. You know, there's some nonverbal cues, you know, that we all know that are important to pick up on, that can tell you a lot where they're at. That's probably our main thing outside of the numbers, you know, just knowing the kids and knowing their attitudes and their body language on a daily basis. That's actually a bigger indicator for us.
So we've talked about risk factors, how to identify specific athletes and when they may be struggling. We're going to move on now, and we're going to talk a little bit about how to engage the athlete once you have that data. And I think that having data is important when you approach somebody who you think might be at risk. You know that there are certain risk factors associated with suicide or other types of risk. You notice something that is changed within that particular person that's specific to them. And that's where your starting point is. That's enough for you to engage in a conversation that might be a little bit more serious. So taking the data that you have, pointing that out directly to the student in a transparent way. When it comes to dealing with students who are at risk, or even if you're talking to a student about something personal, I think transparency, openness, letting them know why you're having the conversation is super important. That way they know what is on your mind right up front. Pointing out the changes, not only that you've noticed, not only demonstrates that you have some knowledge and that you're concerned about them, but it's also an indicator that you notice them. You notice what they're normally like, and then you notice what's going on for them now. And that's a way of connecting with people, noticing who they are, understanding them, even if it's just body language or something like that, like Derek talked about. Your intuition is one of the most useful tools that you have. When you notice something, whether it's subtle or more straightforward, the intuition about what that's telling you about that person is important, and I think sharing that is helpful. Some helpful things that you can do are to be prepared. If you need to write down some of the things that you noticed before the meeting, be prepared to share resources that exist on your campus or in the community. Some things that may not be helpful when it comes to reaching forward and engaging with a student would be to promise confidentiality. The minute that a student says, can you keep this a secret for me, or can you keep this confidential, and you agree, the next thing that comes out of their mouth is going to be something that you're going to have to report almost all the time. And so not promising confidentiality, and also recognizing your scope and as a professional and your expertise, and working within that scope. There are resources on every campus and resources within every community, and using those resources to your benefit is the most important thing. Let's go ahead and turn it over to Gloria. What do you recommend from people in terms of ways to best engage or communicate with student athletes who might be struggling?
Yeah, at the outset, I would say address it immediately. You know, sometimes I think we can bit it off as, oh, they're attention seeking, or they just want, it gets dismissed as in something like, oh, they just broke up with their boyfriend. It's just relationship issues. And we need to be mindful of that, because there's still something going on with the student athlete that needs to be checked in on. And so if we can just put that judgment aside and address it immediately, because, you know, what we want to do is build a rapport, build a connection, so the student can disclose what they're feeling and what's going on with them. And so, contrary to what we believe, actually asking the question, are you thinking about suicide? Are you thinking about killing yourself or harming yourself? Won't plant the idea in their head, right? If anything, you're going to get a couple of responses like, oh my gosh, no way. Like, oh, was I giving off those cues? Or, wow, could you really see that in me? Or, you know, so it could go a couple of ways, but I don't think we could ever go wrong by asking directly about it. And so I think, you know, as best as we can, that's because we want to help the student find options. If they're thinking about suicide, that they're thinking that's the only option to their problem or their pain at the moment. And so I won't take up too much time, because I know our panel has great ways of engaging, but ask about a specific incident, right? Can you help me understand if there's something that happened recently? How did it lead you to this point? And just listening, right? Letting them share their story and verbalize what's going on. A big one is to refrain from invalidating their experiences, right? So, oh, it could be worse. You have cancer. I had a friend that had a brain tumor and this happened and this happened. I think the effort is try to support, but in that moment, your goal is just to listen and just validate what they're sharing, regardless of what you think about it. Because in this moment, it's not about you. It's about centering the student, what they need, and getting them connected to resources. And then, you know, again, just those questions like, can you tell me how you're feeling? Can you share with me, wow, I've been through something difficult as well. It must be hard for you. It would be some quick tips, but being specific and direct. So they understand that you're listening and not kind of checking out or thinking about your own experience. But I think that's the awareness that the coach or staff has to have. How comfortable are you talking about emotions and feelings and listening? Because that's one thing. If you're not comfortable asking directly about suicide, or if it triggers some of your own experiences, then finding a staff person that can address it and that will be more comfortable in being able to get that information from the student so you know how to help them.
Yeah, Gloria, I like what you just said. Center the student, calm them down, engage in a conversation, find out what their needs might be, and then connect them to resources. You know, these conversations seem so complicated, but they are so simple in some ways if you kind of follow that script. Cindy, I was wondering if you had anything to add to that.
Yeah, I mean, essentially two things. One, to not be afraid of connecting with the student around whatever's going on. And again, to dovetail what Gloria said, asking.
I think we may have lost Cindy there for a second. Chris, as in your capacity as an athletic trainer and working with your staff, what styles tend to work for you?
Pardon me?
We lost you there for a second, Cindy, so I was going to move on to Chris. We'll come back to you in a
second. You know, I think Gloria kind of hit everything on the head with this, is, you know, to address this. Don't, you know, in our world in sports medicine, you know, sometimes we get put in uncomfortable situations, and we're the ones that coaches go to, maybe administrators come to and say, hey, you know, something's not right. Can you talk to this kid? So It's getting over that hump. And I think anybody in this profession has had to get over that hump at some point in time. And you have to be okay to approach and address the situation with a student athlete. And I've honestly found, again, I think a lot of it's just when you're first getting into this career path, and it's a nerve-wracking thing. You don't want to tell somebody or ask somebody, you know, are you suicidal? It's not comfortable. It's not comfortable for anybody. And unfortunately, the more you do it, the more you realize that, you know, it's okay. When you sit a student athlete down and have these hard conversations, it's good for them. I mean, I've gotten overwhelmingly positive responses when I sit down and talk to student athletes and address these things. It's almost like a burden, like, well, gosh, I've been waiting for somebody to talk to me about this. So I think just, you know, again, being comfortable in those situations. And I go back to Gloria's point. And I think this is a great point. If you're not comfortable with it, that's okay. Not everybody will be. But find a resource. Find somebody else on staff who has that relationship that's able to address the situation.
Thanks, Chris. Jen, I imagine you often have difficult conversations with students around a variety of topics, academic and other. What's an important strategy that you use when you convey some maybe bad news or you engage in a tough topic?
I would say probably the two things that are the strongest is I express the gratitude to the students for coming in, and then ask, how can I help? I'm noticing this, how can I help? What's happening in this situation? And then express that I'm an advocate for them and here to support them no matter what. Because I think it's really difficult for academic advisors, because many student athletes do not see academic advisors on a daily basis, like the trainers or the coaches or strength and conditioning. And many academic advisors do not have counseling degrees. They are not prepared to do the high level interventions that need to happen, but there's a happy medium in between there. So I think those two things have probably been my biggest go-tos, and then spending a lot of time getting to know the student athlete, listening to them, and especially taking the time to ask them questions. With large caseloads for academic advisors across the country, it's difficult to not be interrupted or have a short amount of time with somebody. So you have to take that time and say, okay, I'm sorry we were interrupted the last two times we met, but I'd like to take some time today to just talk with you a little bit further about your background, and so we can get to know each other a little bit more. And those are really specific things that need to happen on a regular basis because we don't see them every day.
Mm-hmm. I'm just with the sake of time, I think we're going to go ahead and let's spend a little bit of time on the final part of this kind of formal piece of the presentation so we can have some time for questions. But I did notice that there was a question that came up regarding this topic. Staying connected with each other, staying connected amongst professional staff. The panel here today is made up of staff who are engaging with students on a regular basis, whether that's a counseling perspective, strength perspective, or a rehabilitation and training perspective. I think that communication across the board with coaches and other student staff that are working with students is so important. Oftentimes we hold a little piece to a puzzle of the student based on our relationships that we build with them. And then once those pieces are put together and assembled, we can have a bigger picture of what the student might be struggling with. And without that communication in those meetings to talk about them, without setting that aside, we can lose some students or some can get some key areas might be lost. One of the questions that came up, and I'll just pose this to the panel, but what are some of the things that your schools are doing out there in terms of connecting with each other around these types of issues, students that may be struggling, students that may be a concern, and how do you have formal meetings to talk about them, or how does that information get shared? Let's go ahead and start with Gloria.
So in our department, you know, there's annual meetings every semester. So, you know, my resources are often highlighted. I attend every student orientation, new student orientation at the beginning end of the year. So by now, every student athlete at Sac State has heard my presentation and my resources, knows where I'm located, how to get in touch with me directly. I meet with athletic training, and we often meet with student health and counseling services. So I'm still connected and managed with student health and counseling services. And so I think behind the scenes, there's a lot of communication with them when they see student athletes for x-rays or any other referrals that come through. If they're seeing something concerning, they communicate to me. And then likewise, if it's appropriate, I communicate to athletics if possible. But that's a whole other issue about sharing communication and confidentiality. I did want to make sure and just touch on it. Like, I think Cindy was going to make a really good point in regards to how to engage students. So I want to go back to her. Sure. But I know we were talking offline about the power of relationship building, right? And letting just being direct. If I'm meeting with a student athlete and they're saying something really concerning, I will say, I'm really worried about you. I care about you. It's not just my title or my role. And I think when it comes to addressing students in this state, we need to strip off our titles and see them as human beings that are in some pain, and they're very young people trying to figure this out, right? And so I wanted to make sure we touch on that because I think sometimes they see our titles and see us like, oh, head coach doesn't care, or, oh, they're, you know, I don't want to burden them. They're too busy. They don't want to have to deal with my emotional issues, right? But if we can strip that off and say, no, I care about you. I want to know how you're doing or how I can help, can go a long way. So.
Thanks, Gloria. Cindy, we'll put you on the spot. I think at least you cut out on my screen, but did you have more that you wanted to add with regard to the topic of engaging?
Yeah, I think, in some ways Chris spoke to it. But essentially, I think it's a couple things because we're talking about, you know, on an individual level, how to engage. And again, just to reinforce, don't be afraid of the conversations. Kids are usually quite relieved when someone wants to connect with them. And there's a bigger picture issue with mental health is the continued way that it's viewed as kind of other in terms of sports medicine. And Chris, I think, spoke to the way they've integrated it in a very active way. And then also Gloria spoke to it. And I think if part of what we can do as an orientation is And this has to be from the top down in terms of sports medicine, athletic department. Talk to coaches, talk to administrators, talk to everyone about the fact that emotional injury and mental health issues are medical issues, and they're no different than any other physical kind of issue that someone needs. It's not about something over there, that it needs to be integrated. And so if we can open up these conversations as normative and encourage coaches to the extent they're willing to just talk about it in a team meeting, just not in some like all, you know, anxiety driven way, but just, hey, if you've got things that come up, this is talk to your sports medicine person, talk to your athletic trainer. I mean, to make it more normative and normal as opposed to this weird thing in the closet. I think that's the biggest favor all of us can do.
Thanks, Cindy. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and we'll try to weave some of that last topic in as we answer some questions now that we're kind of getting down to some crunch time. One question that came in is, do you think it's important to directly say, are you suicidal? Or is it okay to ask questions like, do you feel safe with yourself? Do you feel safe going home? Those kinds of things. Cindy, let's start with you.
Well, I think in some ways the open-ended questions are going to be the ones you're going to get the most information. Like first, just start with, you know, I noticed this, tell me this. And then you can follow up with, do you ever worry about harming yourself, or what does that look like, or being alone or going home? But to me, if you're at a point where you're saying, do you feel safe? It's no different than saying, do you want to kill yourself? Or do you think about dying? I mean, that's something that's a little easier, is just to say, do you ever think about dying? Or do you ever think about not being here? It's not quite as jarring a term as suicide. Again, I think the student's going to tell you, if they will be so relieved that someone's asking. So I just wouldn't be afraid of it. I think you don't have to be that careful. Kind of like Gloria said, you just don't have to be that careful. Just go for it, but not in some weird way. You know, like, oh my God, do you want to kill yourself? You know, and it's just, well, kind of.
Cindy, I think that was the perfect statement, is just be yourself. Don't need to overdo it. Don't need to be weird, right? We're weird enough on our own without that pressure to say it and ask the questions just right, you know? Another question came in for Jen. Jen made a really good point about athletes changing majors. How do you think we could help support athletes exploring different majors right now when they have less access to internships, job shadowing, et cetera?
That's a super great question right now, because it's so difficult to get anywhere and get in engaged with anyone. Right now at the University of Montana, we have micro internships, which are short events that are scheduled through our career services and academic enrichment office for students to engage in. And we encourage our student athletes to participate in those. They're like 4 hours on a Saturday, where they can meet individuals that and work with individuals in their major area. So I think those are always a great thing. Job shadowing is a little bit more difficult, but in a way that, can you set up a meeting with a student and an individual at a workplace that could be via Zoom? I know that's a little awkward sometimes, but any opportunity to be able to schedule those things where someone could talk and ask questions, I think are important. Another way is to help them identify their strengths and weaknesses through all of the career tests that are available and all of the personality tests that are available online or either through career services. Many programs are going fully online to offer accessibility. So I think those are a few of them. I hope that answers your question a little bit, Taylor. Aaron, before we move into one other thing, can I just add one more comment about the staying connected and a team effort from an advising point of view? I would like to express gratitude to those coaches out there and who do a weekly meeting that include the academic advisors, because oftentimes it usually includes like a trainer and the conditioning and the assistant coaches and the coaches, but there are a number of coaches out there who pull in the academic advisors. So anyone who's listening, if you don't don't pull in the academic advisor. And there's a chance for you to do that either once a month, or if you want to do once a week. It's a great way to build that team effort and help everybody be on the same page to talk about the issues that a student might be going through. So I express gratitude from my end to those at the University of Montana, but also encourage it to happen across schools.
I want to express some gratitude too, Jennifer, because what you, your role and in the exact state, that similar, I could not do what I do without that team. And I feel like I'm a part of that team because they're seeing a different picture, really important piece that when we have to intervene in the student, we have both perspectives. It's just not my clinical perspective. It's, hey, so-and-so's seeing this and they care about you and connected and consulted with me. So I often consult with the academic advisors on that piece a lot. So I appreciate everything you all do.
You know, one of the things we do at Montana State is we have wellness meetings, which includes people just like are on this panel today. We have strength and conditioning, academic support, training, myself, and our counseling center on campus, and we all kind of, medical staff, we all get together and talk about the students that we're worried about, or just talk about things that might or might not be red flags. And I feel like those meetings and just that camaraderie that's built is so important, that so that when somebody's actually struggling, there's some trust and knowledge on how each different member who's crucial is going to help that student get through whatever they're dealing with. We'll follow up and maybe have one last question here. What are some key differences between somebody who might just be sad, someone who's having a hard time going through a transition, dealing with things like COVID, or being homesick versus maybe when they might be suicidal? Like, how do you figure that out? And how do you notice if it's an emergency versus just a normal thing that people are dealing with as they go through life? And I'll just open that up to anyone on the panel who wants to share maybe some thoughts on that.
I'm happy to speak to it. I think first of all, for any of us, our emotional life and our mental health exists on a spectrum. And so it's gonna move on this spectrum, and we kind of want to keep it within a sweet spot, as it were. And so in some ways, I think it's a mistake to view all those things that were talked about in terms of COVID or the this and that as not somehow relating to the other end of the spectrum, because it's progressive and it's subtle. And it's more what one needs to, anyone who's not a trained mental health professional is not in a position to make those distinctions. And so it's important, if you're curious, if part of you wonders, gosh, should I be more worried, then have someone else talk to the student. First of all, don't just think you're supposed to know yourself. I mean, that's why we go to school. That's why we're trained. And then the other part is really around the persistence. Yeah, okay, we can all have a good day or bad day, but if you notice your student around the homesickness or whatever it is, if it persists over a longer period of time, week, two, three, four, or the intensity increases, it's the acuity and the length, then someone needs to talk to them, even if they say, no, you know, I'm just homesick. Well, you know, at that point, it's a little more. Okay, I'll shut up.
No, that's a great point. And I'll just build on that. So one quick thing that, like, I think, that can give you kind of a clue in is, do they have hope or plans for the future? Can they see past this moment? Because severe depression, persistent suicidal ideation, it's like this cloud you can't see past or see through. So, you know, when I see a student, it sounds like to them I'm making conversation, but I'll be like, oh, what's your future aspirations? What's your dream job? Like, can they see themselves 2-3, you know, oh, graduation, like no pressure, but if you got to have your ideal setup, what would that look like? And it's helping me know, is their thought process able to look past this moment? And so those can be very casual questions. It sounds very matter of fact, but it'll clue you into if they're having hope for the future. And if they're stuck and they're not, spend some more time and ask what's going on, right? So that, I think that's, you know, building on what Cindy said, because that's where the intensity and the acuity is just sky high if they can't see past that cloud and that fog. And the other piece, I guess, on the institutional piece, we were also talking offline, is about making sure departments have their mental health emergency action plan and review it. And everybody knows that step. So I know, Cindy, I'll have you chime in right after me on this. But, you know, because it's not, you're not going to be able to pull out the document when there's an emergency and like, who do I call? But it's everyone's responsibility to know it's there, and it should it's a kind of like a living document. It should be reviewed and revised pretty frequently. Anybody? Yeah, I've closed it up there.
Okay. Well, I think it's time to wrap up our conversation, actually. So I just wanted to thank the panelists for joining us today, and all of you out there who joined and sat in and listened. We will be posting the slides up as well as a recording of this if you want to go back and review those at a more leisurely pace. But thank you for joining us, and we hope you have a good rest of the week.